presents a platform with presence in over 30 states of the Federation. Be sure to be heard. For live coverage of events, we have the capacity to deliver from anywhere in Nigeria and beyond. Contact us now on 0803-471-8550 or 0803-724-9733. 014-533-407.
Our 24-hour news station.
Business owners, port users and freight forwarders are usually engaged in businesses here in a normal day, but the explosion which occurred at night made it impossible. The resultant is the beefing up of security leading to traffic jam. The explosion left a fuel tanker, a 40-foot container and a car damaged beyond recognition. It has also led to the death of unspecified number of people with blood stains on the ground. Some eyewitnesses say the blast is beyond an accident.
The fact that we are witnessing this one in Lagos is very glaring, even to a layman, even to somebody that is very blind. You know, this is not a tanker or gas explosion as claimed by the, you know, Lagos State Police Commissioner, because I read it on my Twitter. That it was a gas explosion and, you know, all blah, blah, blah. Everybody can see. Because if it was a gas explosion, can see the truck here. Definitely it would have been blown off. Can see the buildings, about 4 or 5 buildings were involved in this.
It was a massive one. It was a massive explosion. I mean, the carcass of the car, right in the middle of the road, there was a container that was a 40-foot container on top of the truck. It was severely dented, and even opposite the very scene was the former Enterprise Bank. The whole front of the place was damaged. So, I mean, it was a massive explosion.
Spokesman of National Emergency Management Agency Ibrahim Fariloye says the agency's personnel were barred from the scene by police, saying the issue is beyond their jurisdiction.
This is a scene of an explosion that took place at about 9:45 p.m. on Wednesday night at Creek Road, Apapa. Initial reports suggest that it was a tanker explosion, but what we can see here suggests otherwise. It is a call for all Lagosians to be more vigilant. Brownson Uwana, Core TV News, Lagos.
There was a reported case of explosion, non-lethal explosion from an object which was investigated by security agencies at Agbedeke Street, Ile-Ife, Osun State. The outcome of the investigation indicates that the explosion was neither a bomb nor dynamite, but carbide, as neither the ground where the explosion occurred nor the building within the vicinity was affected by the explosion. Just as no human life was lost, neither were the plantain, shrubs and trees, everything around there was destroyed.
There.
Well, I'm sure that you're hearing Matt's voice, but you're not seeing him. Well, what you saw earlier are two reports showing what transpired earlier in Apapa, Lagos, and then in Osun State. We live in a world where almost everything we do is motivated by a basic need to preserve lives, and I'm going to prove it to you. You probably woke up very early this morning and dash out to work to earn a living, to put food on your table, shelter over your head, and probably, you know, provide some quality education for your children. All of it in a bid to preserve life. So when Nigeria joined the list of nations bedeviled by terrorism in 2009, it was an outright threat on that basic desire and that basic need to preserve life. And now we're talking about terrorism in northern Nigeria. You and I are persuaded beyond reason that it's not a northern affair. And that's what we saw earlier, from the suspicious explosion in Apapa to bombs that were detonated in Osun State. And that's why we're asking that big question today. Southwest Nigeria, are the bombers in town? We're joined by two gentlemen, seasoned analyst Wilcox Alexa is a social commentator joining us on the show this morning. Good morning, Wilcox.
Good morning, thank you very much for having me.
Good to have you join us, as well as barrister Chukwuemeka Eze. Good morning, gentlemen.
Good morning, viewers.
Good to have you. Just let's start from the beginning. How did we get to this stage in Nigeria where almost every day on the front page of the paper you see a bomb explosion that has taken lives? Let me start with you, Wilcox. How did we get here?
Thank you very much, and good morning, viewers. I think when you choose to play the ostrich on any serious issue, then you are exposing yourself to a more dangerous phenomenon. And I think that is what we did in Nigeria. Bombing is not, it didn't come strange to any of us because it has been happening. Since the advent of politics, let's even take ourselves back during the time of the late General Sani Abacha. Bombs were being exploded in Lagos by persons. And then, the government was just running around. At the end of the day, it became a point that it was even the government itself that were exploding the bombs. Now, during the aspect of democracy, unfortunately, the actors or our current democratic managers think that the only way they could consolidate their position is through violence and through militia groups. And bombs started exploding in the Niger Delta area. And of course, then too, it could also be traced to the fact that there is some fingers of the those in government, those in court of power. Now, it has gone to the north and it has become a national phenomenon. And when something graduates gradually, it's like when you have a snake. From the early stage, it might be harmless, but the moment it grows and grows and becomes a python, then you know that you have a real problem in your hand. Now, this issue was not addressed from the origin. This issue had the sponsorship of those in the corridors of power at the origin. Like I've mentioned, when the Sani Abacha era was happening, you know, it was very public knowledge that it was the government that was involved. When the Niger Delta freedom fighter coup militants were detonating bombs, bringing down oil installations through bombing and all forms of criminality. We also know that there's also evidence that there were the hands of those at the quarters of power involved. And so I am also of the opinion, and that was that nothing concrete was done. That's why I am also of the opinion, based on certain things that has happened in recent times, that this bombing cannot be too far-fetched. A connection or a capabilities of those also in the corridor of power, and that is why it has gone to this level.
You know, the question that comes to mind now, barrister, is why now? 2014, a centenary year, we're supposed to be celebrating 100 years of Nigeria's existence. It's a year before the general election, 54 years of independence, it's 15 years of democracy. Why now? Why do we have the crescendo and the zenith of explosion?
I think Nigeria is having its own fair share of global terrorism. We have always had local ones. You recall that as far back as 1982, there was the Metesne riot in Bulumkutu in Borno State. We also had the Metesne riot in Kano State. It was quelled. Now, because they did not have the political support, then it was purely religious event. And that was why it was easily quelled. Let me tell you, criminals had always been with us, but they perform better when they are supported by politicians. So in those times, you recall, over time, we've been having religious riots in the north. Religious people will be killed. We run to barracks and nothing will happen. Nobody will be convicted and Nigerians will keep quiet. And another year there will be another religious riot in another place. People will be killed, properties damaged. Nobody will be convicted and Nigerians condoned it. Then suddenly, during the first tenure of Obasanjo, there was this talk about they should do a Mandela. From there, we had a situation where some states began to declare Sharia, cutting the experimented by cutting some people's hands, or attempting to do so. Whereas in the case of OPC, Obasanjo took their leaders to Abuja, detained them, and made them to see the other side of life, and quieting the situation here. In the case of Sharia, he said it was political, and that over time, it will whittle away. Mm. But you have seen that that thing that's partially started as political, the criminal elements now felt the ground was fertile in order to take it to the other end. And that, because if the land is not fertile, they wouldn't have gone to the extent, because all you need for criminals to perpetuate their acts, to have politicians who can save them when they come into trouble. And now they have seen discordant tunes everywhere. Mm. Politicians, some saying this, some saying that, law, some saying fight them. So, and that is, it is in that kind of confusion that they needed to act. Then with the global terrorism fueling it, having found allies, definitely you can see how it is moving. Now, there are other elements that are not linked to that, that have now found a situation like the one happening in the Southwest. Mm-hmm. The scarecrowing, the scaremongering, the wax. So definitely the waters are being tested, but because the environment is not favorable, they indeed will not succeed in the manner they are succeeding in the north.
Indeed, because we must not lose sight that particularly here in the South, or Southwest in particular, the secularity of our religious nature permeates virtually every family from the Southwest. I mean, Christian, Muslims from the same family. So it's not a case of Sharia being practiced around here that can make these people carry their dastardly act to come and be part of us. Are we going to suggest that what is happening around us, in spite of the security situation nationwide, is an isolated case? Paris,
now, what is happening around us? Let me tell you what it requires for one criminal gang to act. If there is an incubated criminal gang here, because they thrive on confusion, they might want to act, but if they discover that the environment is not friendly, they will hold their peace. So, but when there is confusion, because what is happening in the north is trying to put the country in a very confused state, such that, because when people hear bomb here, hear bomb there, they can submit to fear. And once the people submit to fear, that is what the criminal, because I know it that Awolowo children cannot submit to this kind of bombing. The people doing the trying to start bombing in this part of the country, I know that they cannot succeed, because the factors that will make a criminal group succeed, they are not available here. So they can scare, but the level of the bombing taking place in the north will not take place here, except it is done by the children of the land.
Wilcox, before the explosion in Lagos, we had a warning from the U.S. talking about a possible explosion in Southwest, and that warning was specific about Lagos, you know, referring to hotels and all of that. But now we're talking about, we've had threats by Afeniferi and OPC say that if Boko Haram gets to Southwest, we're ready for you. What do you think would be the implication of a possible strike in
Southwest? I have a very divergent view from my colleague. Hmm. It's a divergent view. If we talk about the advent of Sharia and all whatnot, Sharia has failed those that, if you must know. Why General Obasanjo didn't act then? So maybe in his own wisdom, I was one of those that spoke out and said, this man must defend the country, because Nigerian constitution is a secular state. And I shouted, Obasanjo, he must defend the constitution. That was what I said on Radio Nigerian sometime. But, well, he has more wisdom than I do. I believe so. So he kept quiet, and Sharia has almost fizzled out. Nobody talks about Sharia today. Now, the bombing, let me even ask the question, who is people doing this bombing? Because I have a very serious problem. Who is doing this bombing? It's like Boko Haram has become a scapegoat now for anybody that wants to perpetrate any evil. It's Boko Haram. Now, let's cast our mind back. The first bombing in northern Nigeria was done by who? Was done when? October Day bombing. Who did it? Niger Delta militants. Oka has been convicted on that. So one can safely say that bombing was carried out by persons from the South. Because Oka, as we speak today, is serving a jail term in South African court for that purpose. So it's a convicted and documented case. Now, that was the first time a serious massive bombing occurred in this country, in the northern part of Nigeria, and that was in Abuja. Don't also forget that Lagos has been bombed. Atlas Cove was bombed some time back. By who? The Niger Delta militants. So bombing is not an exclusive preserve of so-called Boko Haram. Yeah. And in the last, I can't remember the last time Boko Haram claimed responsibility for any bombing. I can't remember the last time, because they have always claimed responsibility. I mean, when they did certain act, the current leader will always come up and post videos and all whatnot to AFP and to circulate.
Are you suggesting there are many other groups
various cells now that are thriving under the guise of Boko Haram. And I must say this, permit me to say this. A few days ago, a character, Femi Fane Kayode. I'll call him a character because I think he's more of a confucianist or somebody who might classify as somebody that does not understand what really he wants out of life.
In your own opinion.
In my own opinion. Because he woke up on maybe on the very wrong side of his bed and came up to make certain serious, grievous, slanderous allegations. I mean, and I'm telling you, if that allegation was made by anybody against the government, today he will be in the SS cooler, cooling off his head. But it looks like in this country, so long as you speak on the side of government, you can abuse anybody, you can raise any assumption, you can say anything, and nothing happens. If another person has said one tenth of what that character, they said on the characteristics on what about this conflict in Nigeria, I'm sure he will be cooling off in SSS. And I wonder why SSS has not invited him to give more light as to what really he knew. Because he claims he knows a lot about how APC, I'm not an APC member, let me make that clear. I'm not an APC member on anything. But see, we're looking at a country now. He made a lot of assertions as to how APC and characters in APC and as pathetic and Boko Haram being the military wing or the terrorist wing of APC. And so he knows a lot. And I expect that the State Security Service will have invited him over to give light on to so that we bring these problems, we begin to get this problem to a particular level and know how to solve it. But that didn't happen. Now, see, if I will take it from there, and he made one very good statement. He said, people are trying to bomb this president out of office through the APC. So one can then deduce, because if you look at most of the characters that have been linked even to this conflict, this so-called Boko Haram phenomenal conflict, more of the ruling party's persons have been identified to either be, to have been fingered, or to have been sympathizers to this cause. So it can also mean, from Fenerbahce's assertion, that the ruling party is also trying to use this conflict to bomb away the opposition out of relevance.
Barrister, would you say this dimension so is now taken up?
Who is the one doing the bombing?
Would you say this confusion and all of these comments that what we are experiencing in the Southwest is more political than
To me, it's not political. I've told you that criminal gangs, they're always there. They are with us. Even in the pre-medieval times, we had the barbarians. In the medieval times, we had the Vikings. The criminals have always been there. And in states, where in all parts of the world, we have always lived with killings, butchering, bombing, when bomb came out. So you cannot ignore. Now, you at the time we said the world is a global village. The same way it is a global village in watching television, so it is a global village in economics, so it is a global village in terrorism. You cannot tell me that what is happening in Al-Qaeda in the Islamic Maghreb, Al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula, Islamic Maghreb, you don't know the map they use. The map they use continues up to northern Nigeria to Niger, Mali, up to North Africa. So if they use this map and they want to conquer that area, let us stop finding excuses. The fact that politicians are trying to hide either for or against what is happening, put that aside. The truth is that some people may not necessarily be sponsoring them, but when they started, they feel if it is against them, it's better. That opinion alone, that's what a criminal needs to add. When we were contesting election, I recall, just taking it from the point of thugs, thugs will come and plead with you to provide money for India hemp, to provide money for guns, to provide money for bullets. Let me tell you, if they come to you as a contestant and you say you can't give, they meet another person and he says he can't give, they go out of business. But if I give them, definitely they will be in business. So these things we try to call A's name, call B's name, say A political party, B political party. The thing is going around. I remember what happened in Germany. They said it was, as it was happening, they said who was taking the Protestants. They took him away. Later they came for the Catholics. I said I wasn't a Catholic. They took him away. This thing will go around. Violence hardly have boundaries. So why it is good that Afenifere OPC should continue to shout, because when it comes to violence, it's difficult to say this is the boundary. You can call Fanica Ode all the bad names in this world, call Jonathan, call Tinubu. It will stop. Once this is what they thrive on, criminals, just to know that these people are pointing accusing fingers against themselves. It is that confusion that lays the foundation for the activities.
We
should not continue to move in second locution, moving around political characters. This matter is far beyond there. Have you forgotten that something of this nature is taking place in Mali? Have you forgotten something similar to this is taking place in Niger? The Tuaregs. The northern Nigeria is not immune to, because of its closeness to Niger. I quite agree that Niger Delta militants were bombing. But let me tell you, that nature of bombing is different. Because one, General Boyloof, General this, you can point at people who can, then you, when people needed to see them, they will out. Now visit some political leaders who will now own up that if certain things are done for these boys,
you will stop.
Who are those that are owning up?
With respect to.
With respect to the others, with the Boko Haram, that if these things are done for them, we can assure you that they will stop it. Nobody
let me
wants
hold,
to
let me hold you there.
Let us try to draw this discussion towards a solution-oriented path, because the problems are no doubt glaring. How well educated would you say the Nigerian people are as not to be divided along ethnic and religious lines in the fight against terrorism?
That is where I was going. The issue is that in any society where there is a problem, now, there must be leadership. And if it is in a local setting, the chief, the oba, or anybody take leadership and ownership of the problem. Now, in a country or in a system, somebody must take ownership of that problem and say, look, we have, my brother made some very beautiful, but unfortunately is that those who are supposed to be the owners of this problem are the ones that are playing politics with the problem. And that is where the confusion comes in. Because now, We have issues of terrorism like everywhere. Yeah. America had one of the worst incidents of terrorism. That does not stop America from moving on. In the fact that everybody was open on the table, you know that no government apologies was responsible. No opposition apologies was responsible. It was a clear case of criminal elements that was determined to undermine, and the issues were clear. It was clear on the table to every American, so every American can buy in. But today, because of our weak mind, because of our gullible minds, because of our tribalistic tendencies, religious tendencies, political divide, sentiments, and everything, the leaders who are supposed to own up to this process, to this problem, who are supposed to internalize the problem to be their own, are now using that same problem to foster their own political nest. And that is why I said it's a dangerous thing for people to come up and be saying things that they said, that the so-called felt that they said. And that's why I was calling the man a character, because this is not the first time for it. Now, how are we going to educate the Nigerian mind? Everybody is at edge now, because this thing happens repeatedly upon repeatedly upon repeatedly. There is nobody that today that will tell you has the confidence that tomorrow he will leave, because it is a problem that we have allowed. Just take for instance, when this whole thing started, when was accusation? Oh, it is A, it is B, it is C, it is D. Meanwhile, the government is supposed to take responsibility and nip and whatever. Nobody is above the law in Nigeria. Mm-hmm. You cannot be telling me that you know those who are responsible for bombing, who are responsible for terrorism, and you said you cannot, they're untouchable. In a country where the life of everybody is at stake, your own life is at stake, and you say it's untouchable. So Nigerians have been so mentally depleted. Nigerians have been so divided along ethnic, political line. It, rather than what my brother is saying, has become irrelevant, which is the truth. Which is the basic truth, that these things are criminal gangs.
Okay.
Fostered directly or indirectly by the politicians. I agree that there are the political angle to it. No doubt about that.
Mm-hmm.
Boko Haram was started by the former governor of Borno State. That is this president Boko Haram. Nigerians know that. By Sharif. It was a clear case. The Nigerians. So why are we not calling a spade a spade? Why are we always being that? It was started through those kind of political conquerism. You want to conquer your political empire. You want to maintain relevance. Rather than going to the masses to canvass for vote, you want support of group that will intimidate others. Just like every person has done. It has done in the Southwest. People need to cut OPC. People need to cut Egbesu. People need to cut the whatever group exists in the East. So you have those come and support. Rather than going to the masses to say, look, give me a vote for this and this reason. No, people want to cut corners. Person wants to cut corners because the institutions are so weak. The system is so porous. There is so sentiment. There is no the poor education level, poor political culture level. To politicians capitalize on that. That is the obvious part. But now it has gone far beyond where they started. And that is where I think years back, everyone should have come back and look into what my brother is saying.
This is pure criminality
that is being fostered on the people. And like you said, when that confusion existed, then people will take advantage. Moreover, when the security forces are weak, there is a blame game. A is blaming B, B is blaming. Rather than addressing problem, you are blaming system. And meanwhile, who is dying? The common Nigerians.
Thank you. Are you saying the security forces are weak? In the sense that we, now we've been able to disabuse the notion that these are influences of terrorism from the north that is touching even southwest. And the other day we heard of the arrest in southeast, in Abia, which some people have been repatriated to their various states. Are we suggesting the weak security forces, even in these areas? Because if you take Ife, for instance, that is a metropolis that it is unlikely that any kind of terrorist activity will succeed in that place, in spite of your historical background.
I just want to let you know that a people cannot leave their security entirely in the hands of security agents.
So not in the hands of governments?
Everybody must become a security officer in the kind of environment we have found ourselves, because necessity is the mother of invention. The time we did not care who dropped a big nylon bag somewhere, after all, it's not my business, that time is gone. Everybody, in fact, we don't have the ratio of security men as per the right number in terms of population. We don't have the right security number. So we can never have sufficient security men everywhere in this country. So that is why we need a rethinking on what we mean by security. What the security agents need to do is, when complaints are sent, to leave a communication channel so that ordinary people can call easily and communicate with them, and the response time should be so fast. Because a situation, somebody from the National Confab said that there was attack on villages around Chibok for 8 hours, or in Yobe State, for 8 hours, and there was no intervention. That is what we don't want in this country. We want security agents to react to any attack within 30 minutes, if they can have this response time. That is what Nigeria, but they too have their challenges. It will be difficult to have a very active and performing security when politicians are divided. Take Iraq, for example. Why Iraqi army is not performing well? They tried to restrain ISIS from Fallujah and Anbar provinces. Mm-hmm. They didn't succeed because the security agencies were divided by religion and tribe. And recall, at the commencement of the, prior to the civil war, immediately killings were done to show, to be perceived as having political, tribal, or religious coloration.
Mm-hmm.
It weakened the security people. So usually, the division I see among politicians in terms of security matters, that is the real reason why the security cannot perform.
Mm.
Because every politician has a friend or has a brother in the security agency. And the people you call your security members of the security, they are human beings. They are Nigerians. They have their religion. They have their tribe. They have their preferences. They are not from the moon. So unless politicians come together and stop this name calling and take it as a nationalistic effort to stop this carnage, then except we do that, we'll be either on the road to Somalia or on the road to Rwanda.
Are you sure we're not even past Somalia?
Wilcox, some have debunked the possibility of military might overcoming the war against terrorism in Nigeria. It's obvious from the abduction of the 219 Chibok girls,
yes,
months now after... the presidential committee has brought it down to 219.
No, 219 still
after
missing.
The escape.
Still missing. After the escape.
Yes.
And now we're talking about a situation whereby we have international commitment, but months into that abduction, they're still far away. Would you agree with me that this is more of a political and religious fight rather than a military fight?
Yes, no. They see, the problem is this, like I have said, the ownership of the problem. Now, for me, the buck stops on the decks of the president, because the issues of national security lies solely on the federal government. Now, no state has even a Boy Scout that can challenge anything. No state has right to arm, right has to anything.
Security. Are you suggesting state police?
No. I'm not even suggesting state police. Mm. What I'm saying is, I like the way it is. I have never been a proponent of state police. But the fact now is that persons that hold public office must hold that public office in trust and must defend the tenets of that public office. If a president, he must preside well. Now, security is the issue, is the prerogative of the presidency of the federal government. Therefore, anybody who is saying, hey, what is the state government doing now, must be, it's just being an ostrich, because you should know that it is not a concurrent responsibility, it's a centralized responsibility. Now, we've had it, in this country, we've always had, when armed robbers hold the nation by the jugular, what we keep hearing, the superior firepower of the armed robbers was that bigger than the police. Superior firepower of the armed robbers is bigger than the police. Now we keep hearing that superior firepower of the robbers. Now we have terrorist situation in our hands. We are not saying that the superior firepower of the terrorists is higher than that of our military. Every time when are we going to do the catch up? Now, and don't forget, defense has taken so much of our national budget. Defense has taken, in the last 5 years, defense has taken so much of our national budget. What was those money meant for? So for me, I think somebody's benefiting. It's not just because it's political or something. This matter can be dealt with military to a level. You don't negotiate. Like last time I came here, when we were talking about negotiation, I said you don't negotiate from a position of weakness. Before America started negotiating with Afghanistan forces, they have come to a position that they have weakened them properly. That it cannot be solved militarily completely, but you must come to a position where you know that you have what it takes to grab the political solution. But it's just whereby you don't have what it takes. They are still defeating you militarily at the military front. If you're going to any political solution, you're going just going to submit.
We hold our hands and just say that these people should go ahead and do that?
No. The government must step up the game. Like you said, the president must come beyond partisanship. He is being confused by persons who are profiting from the situation. The president is being, and I keep saying anywhere I go to, his political capital is being depleted by those who are supposed to help him. Now, what people are feeding him with is the fact that, this is politics. People are, it's at 2015. It's 2015. Everybody's focal point is on 2015. And the president is being deceived and derailed to be focused on 2015 as the base of this conflict. Yeah. Meanwhile, the conflict has gone far beyond 2015 level. So what am I saying? It is time the president puts on his thinking cap and know that persons around him are those that are part of his worst political, are those that his political enemies, not even the political opposition, because they are the ones.
Those assertions are looking a little more personal with respect to whether the president is doing something or not.
No, he's but doing. That, we he's know doing, he's, but he's not showing. He's doing a lot. A lot is being done.
Let me hold you there.
Every person may boil. This thing is not the president's only problem.
Indeed.
Let me tell you, all the states need to give the president moral support. They need not necessarily contribute ammunition. It is that, let me tell you, there is power in human feeling, human contribution, even by words. If all the 36 states, their politicians come together, for instance, as my brother here is railing against Fani Kayode now, and Fani Kayode is railing against APC, that is what they need to be causing confusion. By the time you reduce this problem we should come together. Leave Fani Kayode alone. Mm-hmm. Leave President alone. Mm-hmm. Leave Lai Mohammed. Leave everybody alone. Because the people being killed, these are brothers and sisters, and even if you decimate any of these people you are talking about, an idea whose time has come, nobody has stopped it.
Just a minute, Barrister, just hold your thoughts there. In a bit to describe our try in these times, many have referred to the secession civil war between 1967 and 1970. And the big question is, how united are Nigerians today? How prepared are we to stay together as a nation as against the secession that almost tore us apart in the civil war? That will be what we'll be discussing, but we come back shortly after this break. Don't forget, it's the big question, Southwest Nigeria. Arthur Bomber's here. Don't go away.
You can now watch Core TV News live from anywhere in the world on our website, www.coretvnews.com. Click on Live TV on our website and watch us live.
And welcome to Core TV Primetime News.
To follow us on Twitter, click on Twitter icon on our website. And Facebook, click on the Facebook and YouTube to see all our previous news production. You can also watch us live on YouTube. Click Core TV, leave a space, then news. Core TV News, a 24-hour news station.